Hi, everyone. I'm Olga Villaverde, and welcome to our Broward County Back to School Town Hall. Today, we're going to be addressing different questions and concerns that parents have as the new school year is rapidly approaching. We're going to be talking about going to school at home and what to expect when we eventually move back to in-person classes, which I'm sure everyone one day will be looking forward to that. First, I'd like to introduce our wonderful guest joining us. We have Dr. Valerie Wan. To all of you.
Great to be here.
Thanks so much for joining us. Great to have you. Now, before we get into our wonderful discussion, I do just want to mention to our viewers who are watching that we're going to be posting a link to our town hall survey in the comments below. Watch out for that, because as a thank you to the first 50 people to fill out the survey, they will receive a $50 gift card to a local South Florida restaurant. Also, want to remind our viewers that if you are watching, please send in your questions below. We are going to get to them throughout this live session. So once you get to them, my producer will send them to me and I will read it to our wonderful panel. All right, so Dr. Wanza, I'd like to start with you if possible. I know you are very busy with the school district and getting ready for the new school year. Are we looking at online classes?
Hi, thanks for having me to represent Superintendent Runty in the school district. Yes, we are looking to open the school year next week, Wednesday, fully online for all students.
I guess my next question as a mom, and again, any moms out there or dads who'd like to chime in, please send in your questions. It's hard to tell at this point, but do you know when you might be reassessing that situation where then we can start looking forward to the back to in-person classes?
Thank you. Thank you for that question. So we certainly recognize that opening schools in the normal fashion is essential to establishing normalcy for our community. We are assessing community conditions every single week. And we are, as soon as conditions improve in our community for us to begin reintroducing our students back to our campuses, we will do that. But we are assessing conditions every single week. At our last school board workshop, there was some discussion around looking in after the first 2 weeks of school to really start to look at the possibilities. But again, we are assessing conditions every single week.
So as a parent, let's say in Broward County, who is now facing the fact that the child will be going into online classes, Dr. Wanza, can they at least think that possibly if conditions get better, the situation improves, that it could be hopeful for October, November, December?
So I don't want to give people a false sense of security and put an actual time frame on it. Our hope is that we could have opened the school year with as many kids in our campuses who wanted to return. But I can tell you that we certainly would like to see some kind of return to campus within the first quarter of the school year, but we can't put a time frame on it until our community commits itself to improving the conditions so that we can welcome our students back on campus.
Fair enough. Dr. Manley, let me bring you in. We ended the school year, obviously, with online classes. And, you know, the children, just like my children, I would think they acclimated as best they could. Now that we're starting the new school year in the same scenario, how do we prepare our children mentally for just the fact that, you know, here we go again?
Sure, and thank you for having me. I think what we can do best is try to just prepare them, right? We have a better sense of what it's gonna look like. I think it's gonna feel more organized now. But giving them a sense for any adjustment that we're moving towards, if we give a kid a sense of what this is going to look like, reassure them that they can handle it, that's going to be really, really important. And more than anything, we as parents set the tone. So even if this is not ideal, even if this isn't our first choice, if we are communicating just pure anxiety or frustration, our kids are going to pick up on that. So if we can acknowledge that this is tough, but also reassure them and help them focus on how they're going to get through and be optimistic, that's really going to help them move through what might be a difficult adjustment.
Dr. Constant, I'd like you to chime in on this as well, because I'm sure you have parents asking you as well, just tips on how to prepare just for a healthy beginning for these children who really were possibly looking forward to going to school and once again are facing online.
Right, absolutely. Well, thank you for having me. And what I'd like to say is that we've spoken a few times this summer regarding this topic. And I think I mentioned before that through the summer, our job as parents was to prepare our children for the fact that perhaps they would not return to school. So that right now, this week, it's not a bomb that we're dropping on them, this horrible, you know, news that you're not returning. So I think the idea was to prepare them slowly for, you know, for the options or the possibility to stay home. And right now, just talk to them and tell them this is not permanent, but this is something that we're going to have to do for the greater good. This is what we're doing to stay safe, to stay healthy, and it's our best option for now.
All right. I have a question that just came in where my producer has been sending them to me, and I want to get to it immediately. This mom writes, my daughter has autism, and we are going crazy. Is there any place we can get help until school starts? And we talked a little bit about that in our last town hall last week, children with special needs. Dr. Wanza, I'm going to give that one to you if possible.
So I will start, and I certainly, and then I will obviously allow my colleague, Cindy Ehrenberg-Seltzer, to answer as well. So teachers are at school now pre-planning. We certainly are very sensitive to the needs of all of our parents, but in particularly our parents of students with special needs. I have a nephew with autism, so I certainly understand the concern. I can tell you that once school begins, we will be communicate to parents the various methods that they can access services during the school day, and even some services that we will provide to parents after school hours. But I'm going to allow Cindy, if she will, to talk about the services that are available in the community before the start of school.
Absolutely. Because Cindy, I know you are at the Children's Services Council and you provide different programs and resources to help families with children with special needs. So please help this mom and let her know what she can do.
So I want anyone with a child with special needs to know that through 211 Broward, and you can get there by calling 211 or on the web, 211broward.org. There is a special needs hotline and special needs resources. So they can connect you with a lot of resources in the community. Obviously, there are not as many in-person resources as there normally would be, but there are some respite services. There are virtual services to help. But the key to that is 211 Broward. And if the diagnosis is new or you need some special help, there are case managers available who have a specialty in special need, children with special needs. Please take advantage of that.
And Cindy, I wanted to follow up because, again, we had this conversation last week in our town hall, and I have a friend of mine who also has a special needs child. And she has felt that her child has been delayed even more due to all of this. What words could you give to those parents who feel that those children, unfortunately, are maybe falling behind now?
Everybody is facing that. And I'm sure the doctors and Valerie will agree. You know, we're all facing the same challenges. Of course, children with special needs, it's even more advanced, but take advantage of whatever services are available. And I promise you, when people get back to normal, I know the school district, all of the service providers throughout Broward County will be there to provide extra support to try and help them catch up. But there are tools available, and I hope you'll take advantage of them.
Thank you, Cindy. Again, I want to remind our viewers, if you are watching this town hall, which has to do with Broward County, please send in your questions in the comments below and we will get to them immediately. Dr. Wanza, here's my question, and I think it's an important one. when and if things go back to normal, what does it look like then? What can parents expect Broward County Schools to do to keep their children safe?
Thank you. So the first thing I'll say is that we recognize that until there is some type of widely tested and approved vaccine, many of our parents may elect to keep their students at home. So we know that we have to have an e-learning or online option for parents who choose to keep their students at home, even though our schools have reopened. What I can tell you is that when we start to reintroduce students onto campuses, we will have very aggressive plans and measures as they relate to personal protective equipment for staff. Also, what that means for students, we will look at how we would continuously clean and sanitize our school buildings throughout the school day and then take an even deeper clean after school hours. Also looking at how we would potentially reduce class sizes to comply with what are the CDC guidelines at the time that we reopen. So we have a lot of thoughtful measures, and they are all posted on the school board's website, www.browardschools.com, in our official school reopening plan that was approved by the board on Tuesday.
All right, Dr. Mandler, I have a couple questions for you since Dr. Wanza was talking about online classes. It has its difficulties, let's be honest, for some children. What would you say are some of the pros to online learning? Maybe even discuss some of the cons, if you will. And are there any mental health issues that you see more during this time of back to school? I gave you three questions in one. My apologies.
Sure. Well, I'll jump in. Anytime we're going back to school and anytime there's any significant adjustment, we typically see some kids having a little bit more difficulty at that time, and we were mentioning kids with special needs before, those children may be particularly at risk or just at risk for a little bit more difficulties with the adjustment. If we're talking about kids with ADHD or autism or learning disabilities, that's often a little bit more challenging as we get back to school. But there are mental health concerns in both directions, right? If we're going to school, you know, kids are going to be anxious about getting COVID and potentially passing it on to a parent. There are mental health concerns. Kids are feeling isolated. Kids are feeling down and anxious to get back to school. So there are concerns on both sides. And so what we want to do is do what we can to deal with the reality that we are in, which is right now, which is remote learning. That's what's going to keep us physically safe. And whether it's connecting with the right resources, parents setting the right tone, or identifying whichever helpful services are needed to ease that transition, that's what we've got to do, because that's currently where we are.
All right. I have another question from a viewer, and I'd like to get to it if possible. Dr. Wands, I'm going to pose this one for you, if I may. Some of the people in my church don't have Wi-Fi. How are their kids supposed to learn this way?
So thank you for that question. Across the school district, we have provided free Wi-Fi mobile hotspots because we recognize that is a strain and a burden and a challenge for some of our families. We've also been connecting them to affordable Wi-Fi services. So what I would say is any parent who has concerns about their children not only connecting to the Wi-Fi, but also needing a device to participate in e-learning, please call their local school.
Fantastic. All right, Dr. Constant, I'd like to bring you in. Ironically, I was taking my girls the other day to get that yearly checkup and, the shots and all that. Those back to school checkups. Are you hearing concerns? First of all, are parents doing that? And number two, what concerns are you hearing from parents now? Because I even had my concerns as I was discussing, just your meningitis shot. And then here I went COVID.
Right, right. So yes, we have a ton of parents. Families are coming in every day for their physicals because at least we're in the Dade County public school system. So Dade County is requesting the forms. They want them in by a deadline. So we do have a mad rush into the office, getting vaccines and getting physicals completed so that they can have their forms to turn into the schools. And then the concerns, yes, a lot of parents are still concerned about the safety of their children. They're asking me what I think and should they send their child, because as you know, there's the idea that we're going to go virtual and then possibly in person, I think in October. And we also have students that are in private schools and some private schools are actually opening in person. So a lot of parents are very concerned. They want to know what they should do and what the best decision is and how to keep their children safe.
Dr. Wanza, quickly, does Broward County also require the forms as well? I just wanted to ask you that real quick.
So absolutely. We certainly will require all of the immunizations and health records that are necessary for children to enter campus when we begin to offer instruction on campus. Absolutely.
All right. I'm glad I wanted to know that, because since we're dealing with Broward, I wanted to make sure. Cindy, I wanted to get to this because I found this to be fascinating. One of the programs that the CSC is working to fund is something called Learning Pods. Learning Pods. Can you tell us what that is and who this program is intended for? Are they for anyone? Again, lots of questions. Sorry, I'm just trying to get it all in before our town hall is over.
That's all right, but you wanted me to answer short, and it's a lot of questions. So we've heard, I'm sure your viewers have seen a lot and heard about pods that parents are creating on their own and trying to hire teachers, etc. A lot of the funders have come together, the Children's Services Council, the United Way, some private foundations, to look at how those could be put together for low-income families. There are a lot of families who cannot afford to hire their own teacher or bring their own staff in. And so we have an application on the street right now for both child care providers and our typical after school programs to see if they have the capacity to open up for what are being called pods. So there would be one responsible adult for 9 children so that we stay within that guideline of 10 people in a space at once. That adult would supervise those children as they go through their Broward County Public School e-learning day. So for families who are working, where they don't have anyone to watch their child while they are at work and they want their e-learning program to be supervised, that's the idea behind this. They're still in the application stage. We're hoping to get some up and running right, probably not on the first day of school, but soon thereafter. We will be advertising them through the Broward County Schools website, the Children's Services Council, the United Way. We'll get the word out as broadly as possible to let parents know. But it is specifically for low-income parents, free and reduced lunch parents. And while they're there at the pod, they will get their lunch, their snack, and be supervised. They'll also have the free time, etc., that will be built in. And the anticipation is that they'll be able to be there all day, including, you know, what would be considered the after school hours.
What a wonderful program. Thank you for sharing that.
For those who can't take advantage of the pod, the virtual after school programs with all the enrichment and the tutoring, et cetera, that are usually provided by the Children's Services Council through our many nonprofits are still being offered.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Cindy. Again, reminding our viewers who are watching our town hall, if you have a question, please send them in and we'll get to them as soon as possible. I do have a question here. This parent poses this question. I'm worried about my son. This is such an important question, and I think so many parents can relate. I'm worried about my son. He seems so lonely. He misses school and being around students. I think we can all chime in on this. Dr. Mandler, I'm going to have you take it. And then Dr. Cossett, I'd like you to piggyback if possible.
Yeah, the first thought that crossed my mind was me too. I just want to acknowledge for whether it's adult or especially a kid, acknowledge that feeling of loneliness and that desire to get back to being with friends and back to what feels normal is totally appropriate, and it's nearly universal. So I want to be able to acknowledge that. And then I want to help that child find maybe creative ways to connect. And it might not be the same, it might not feel the same as being there in the room with somebody, but whether it's something outdoors that feels safe, or even online through Xbox, again, not ideal, but we have to find creative ways. So acknowledge it and then try to find these ways to connect these kids at a time where it's really difficult.
Dr. Constant?
Right. I totally agree. I was thinking for my children as well that we would get them together with one or two friends that in a safe way so that in between classes or in between those blocks of virtual learning that they could at least ride their bikes together and just hang out, the nice social distancing visit, but just to feel that you're connected with your friends again. It's totally understandable and everybody feels isolated right now. So I think that's a great idea as long as we're safe about it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Dr. Wanza, would you like to chime in on this?
I would. And the first thing I want to do is I want to thank all of our teachers who really and truly in a moment's notice had to flip on a dime and arrange online learning without any notice or really preparation to do it. Now that we've gone through the summer and teachers have participated in a lot of professional development on their own time, also this week prepping for school, I think that one of the things that parents can appreciate, if anything, about us opening school this way that will be a lot different is the amount of interaction during the time that students will be on online. And we find that it will be more enhanced than what they may have had in the spring. So even that virtual interaction with their peers will assist in some way.
Absolutely. And Dr. Wanza, if I could just follow up with a question. How do you think we should best prepare our children when that time comes to go back? There will be some nerves, maybe a little anxiety, excitement. I think there's going to be a lot of emotions.
So I want to echo the sentiments of my colleagues here joining us in this town hall this evening. I think as adults experiencing this, a lot of us have anxiety, we have fears. We miss even the normal interaction that we have with our peers. So I think for our students, it's really going to be about the conversations that we have with them as we transition them back from the online space into the brick and mortar, really the reminders about appropriate social distancing, the reminders about, you know, the PPE that we're all going to have to wear. And really just doing those constant reminders and constant emotional support for them. Because as I believe Cindy said it best, this has been something that all of us have experienced and have been impacted and affected by.
Absolutely. And Cindy, I have a question that I want to get to from Sandy. I just wanted to ask you this quick question. When we start transitioning back to in-person classes, will the learning pods continue to be available?
So it's really going to be dependent upon how we reopen. Once children are really allowed back in campus, my assumption is that it will be safe to do so. So I'm not sure that the pods will be necessary. If you're comfortable enough to go back and have your children be with other children, you'll probably be comfortable sending them to school. But, you know, we're all building this plane as we're flying it. So I think, you know, it's very uncomfortable for our children and for the adults to deal with all of this uncertainty. Believe me, I know. Those of us who are trying to plan and move big systems and manage our own children and our own, you know, lives, I get it. But
right.
I think us taking deep breaths and reminding ourselves of the patience and the resiliency that we're building in ourselves, that also translates to our children. They are learning good coping skills now. If we can help them learn those coping skills, they will stand them in good stead the rest of their lives.
Absolutely. And Dr. Constant and Dr. Mandler, I'm going to ask you a follow-up to this question as well. This is a great question from Sandy. And Sandy, thank you so much for asking this one. Dr. Constant, how do we convince kids to wear masks? It's one thing for me to tell Samantha and Daniela, who are teenagers. It's another thing to tell a six-year-old or a seven-year-old or a four-year-old.
It's not. My kids are six and four. They've been amazing. Absolutely amazing. They understand what's going on. You talk to them. They understand that everybody wears masks. And there is, I'm shocked. I think that the problem is more my husband and I. We're like, oh, it's hot or sweaty. We pull it down, we put it up, we pull it down again. But the kids are totally fine. They understand, they keep it on, and there's no problem. You know, as long as they understand why they're doing it. I think that what we have to remember is that communication is key with our children, no matter what age. And if they understand why they're doing something and it's for the greater good and for their health, there's really absolutely, there's no resistance. So I will say my kids are not perfect, trust me, but with the masks, it's been flawless.
And I'll say,
boy, that's fantastic.
We've seen that in the summer programs. We had some programs that were open throughout the summer for elementary school age children, and the children were terrific. They really listened. They followed directions. They used their own manipulatives. They wore their masks. As Dr. Constant said, they were much better than the adults.
Dr. Wanza, your thoughts?
Yes. So, you know what? Children typically rise to whatever expectation we have of them. So if we communicate the expectation, communicate the why, and give them the constant reminders, they typically comply.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Mandler, it kind of goes back to something you said when we started the town hall about children are sponges. You know, they kind of mimic what we're feeling. The communication is very important, isn't it? Especially, it's always important. That's pivotal. I think communication is key to any relationship, yes. But today more than ever.
Yeah, I mean, my fellow panelists nailed it. Communication is critical. Sometimes we avoid it thinking, you know, a kid can't handle this, but they fill the void then with their imagination, which is often worse. So just like Dr. Constant was saying, giving them the information, why we're doing it in a developmentally appropriate way, that's going to work. And also we can make it fun, right? My nephew has a Paw Patrol mask and he's 4 and he like wants to go to sleep with it. So we can be creative in the way we do it, but communication, as everyone has mentioned, is going to be key.
Dr. Wanza, I'm curious, when things go back to normal, and I say that very cautiously, will parents have the choice of keeping their children home if they just don't feel it is time?
Absolutely. We recognize that until some type of vaccine is normalized throughout our community, throughout society, there are just going to be parents who are not comfortable. We respect that. And we will all, and we know that we must maintain an online or some type of hybrid model option for those parents who just are, as you said, just are not comfortable sending their children back to school yet.
I'm so glad you brought up the hybrid. So glad you did that, Dr. Wanza, because I find that to be such a wonderful idea where it kind of helps everybody, you know, dip their toe in the pool for a moment and then see if it's cold and then maybe just wait a little bit. And then, you know how we say you jump in the pool maybe after a little while. So it kind of helps everyone do a smoother transition, if you will. Do you think so?
So yes, if you will notice, initially that was the model that we spent the most time discussing and planning for. And unfortunately, our conditions in the community won't even allow for that at this time. But we do recognize that we are going to have some type of an e-learning or a hybrid model for parents. And you know, families who they just aren't comfortable yet, or let me try it. And then let me ease back into it.
Dr. Constant, do you get that from families who feel like maybe just opening that door and rushing back just isn't the answer, even when the opportunity arises?
Yes, we have kind of a mixed review, but yes, there are some parents that would like to just see, and you know, there are a lot of precautions that have been put into the classroom. So a lot of parents feel very comfortable with the desks further apart and smaller class sizes. So they do want to go in as far as hybrid mode. And then I have the complete opposite where parents are saying, no way, I don't want to send my kids to school yet. But just to piggyback on what Dr. Wanza was saying, that truly it just depends on the state of our community. It depends on the numbers. And if our community is safer and the numbers are coming down, then that will translate to having a safer classroom.
Absolutely. As we're wrapping up our fabulous town hall with all four of you, I want to ask one question to each of you before we say goodbye. Cindy, again, I want to talk about the programs that can help people with special needs, children with special needs. What sort of services does the CSC offer in case someone is joining us now? Because I think they are imperative, especially during this time. Where can people also go, which I think is important, to donate their time to providing volunteering services to the Broward community? Again, a lot of questions.
So I'd like everybody to remember 211 Broward, which you can get to by phone or by email, to find the services, whether they're funded by the Children's Services Council or anybody else. It's a great key to that information. Or you can go to the CSC website, www.cscbroward.org, and look at our funded programs guide. There are programs for almost anyone who needs them. The other, although many of them at this time are virtual, so I'm sorry about that, but everyone needs to stay safe. And then if your child needs community service hours, or if you would like to help in the community, please go to handsonbroward.org and look for a place to volunteer. Your time and energy are needed. And if you are able-bodied and healthy, please do help.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that. I have a question from a viewer I'd like to get to. I'm a parent and I'm concerned about my child's friend. She comes from a, quote, difficult family, and things have been tougher than normal at home. Anything I should look out for? Dr. Mandler, I'm going to give that to you.
Yeah, I think for this parent, or if we're looking at this child or a teen, one of the things we really want to look for is change from previous functioning. Excuse me. So if a kid seems to be happy-go-lucky for most of their life, and all of a sudden they're sad or they're irritable, a marked shift in their mood or their personality, that might be a red flag and cause for trying to connect either to the right services or to a professional.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Mandler. Dr. Wanza, any last pieces of advice? You've been fantastic. We so appreciate your time. I know how busy you must be. For just parents who are worried about the upcoming year, worried about their child maybe not learning the same online as in person. That's my concern, for example. But just any final tips of advice for parents out there regarding Broward County Schools?
So let me start by saying this is my 29th year with the Broward County Public Schools. I'm also a product of Broward Schools. But for the first time in 29 years, I am not going to school the first day of school. And I understand and I feel, and so do all of our teachers, our school leaders, all of our support personnel, bus drivers, cafeteria workers, the facility service people, security secretaries, everybody across the organization. We are here to support our families. We understand that they're going to have needs that we have to meet in different ways, and we are going to meet them where they are and assist our families in helping them to get through this. No one understand that opening this school year is going to take a measure of grace and patience that none of us ever thought we would have to experience. But we recognize that we only get one shot at educating kids. It's going to be different this year, but we're going to make the most of every single moment and every single opportunity that we have. If you have a question, please call your child's school. We are here to help.
God bless you. That's wonderful, Dr. Wanza. Dr. Mandler, in a previous town hall, and I take notes when I have my guests on, you mentioned that it's okay to sometimes take a step back and just say, you know what? I'm frustrated. This sucks. It's okay, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And especially for parents, that's just more genuine. And helping a kid acknowledge and validate what they're feeling is critical. If we just skip directly to, oh, it's going to be okay, or here's how to solve the problem, it doesn't feel like they get it. Those parents get it. So if we pause and acknowledge that, yeah, this is tough, then we can shift to providing information, reassuring, helping them figure this thing out. That first part is critical.
Absolutely. And Dr. Constant, I'm not sure if she can hear us. Can you hear me, Dr. Constant? Okay, so fantastic, because I know we had a lot. Fantastic. We got you back, which I'm so glad we did, so we could end our town hall with all of you. any final tips for parents, Dr. Constant, in terms of their fears, their anxiety with the new school year, which is, I mean, for my daughter, it's next week.
Right. Absolutely. Well, I would say that I think it's important once we start the school year to go back to our structured schedule, just to keep things as normal as possible. So waking up and, you know, waking up at the right time, getting yourself ready. I think that's really important just so we have a little bit of a structured system. And, you know, just to be supportive of your kids, it's going to be very difficult. They're going to be very frustrated. And I think that this is going to be a family effort to help them through this, because at the end of the day, we still want them to learn. You know, I know your daughters are older. Your youngest is older and preparing for college. So you want this to count for her and you want it to mean something. So absolutely, we need to be patient and supportive of our kids and help them through this.
So glad that technical issue ended, because that was beautifully said. Thank you so much. That's all the time we have for today's town hall. I want to thank all of you. God bless you all for what you do. Again, a shout out to Dr. Valerie Wanza. Thank you for coming in. And I know, again, you're swamped. I get it. And I'm so sorry after 29 years, you're not going to be at the school. I can only imagine how the students are going to miss you. But soon they'll be there with you, Dr. Wanza. Again, Dr. Leon Mandler, thank you so much. Dr. Scarlett Constant and Cindy Ehrenberg-Seltzer, thank you so much for what you do for those children with special needs. I do appreciate your time.
Thank you, Olga.
Thank you for having me.
And I just want to remind our viewers, please tune in next week when we'll have our last back to school town hall. This one will have a focus on Miami-Dade County. And obviously it's different from Broward County as well. That's why we want to address Miami-Dade as well. Make sure to have your questions ready. Again, it's going to be on next week. And when we know the exact date, we'll be putting it on our Instagram, on our Facebook, on all our social media pages, so you can be there as well. Also, be sure to watch the Health Channel on South Florida PBS stations to watch a recording of this town hall, as well as other back-to-school town halls that we've done. And that's it. I wish you all so much luck in the new year. I hope your children are blessed with wonderful studies and health. And we thank you so much for tuning in today. And thank you for always supporting South Florida PBS.